Welcome to this channel. Hello, everyone. My name is Zuhir Chaudhary. So today we will discuss about methods of pest control and pesticide resistance. As we talk about method of pest control, the main thing that is applied in agriculture is integrated pest management, or IPM. And so the goal of integrated pest management, or IPM, is to control pests, not to eliminate them, by using a variety of methods to keep each pest population just below the size that causes economic loss. And in fact, in here you can see that here you have a pest population that is steady state going up and down by using integrated pest control system. You can reduce this pest so that it is lower, so that it is below the economic threshold. So you can still make significant money out of your crops, but the pests are not fully destroyed from the ecosystem. And that helps to avoid resistance, which we'll talk later. So each crop and its pest are evaluated as parts of an ecological system, and control program developed include a mix of cultivation practices, biological methods of pest control, as well as chemical control methods as well. So in here, we can see some of the IPM methods of pest control. So many tactics keep pest population off balance and avoids development of resistance to pesticides. Least toxic effective methods are used before more toxic ones whenever possible. The goal of using multiple tactics or small, like many small hammers, is to effectively suppress pests below injurious levels and avoid outbreaks. So the first types of practices are listed in here, which is cultivation practices. The goal in here is to suppress pest problem by minimizing the conditions they need to live, so that the water, the shelter, the food, you're trying to minimize those, so the pest cannot, like, they don't like it over there. So planting plants that are adapted to your growing conditions, as well as planting them in the right place, are also very critical, so that the plant can actually thrive and fight pests by itself as well. Strong plants, a plant resists diseases, outgrow weeds, and are less likely to succumb to insects. Other cultivation practices could be rotating crops every year, planting trap crops to lure pests away, adjusting planting times, intercropping, as well as polyculture. Beside cultivation practices, you may also employ physical methods as well. So prevent pest access to host or area, or if the pests are already present in that area, physically removing them by some means. For example, this could mean using barriers, traps, vacuuming, mowing, or tillage, depending upon the pest and the situation that arises there. You could also use genetic methods. So use pest-resistant plant varieties developed by classical plant breeding. Recently, this category has been expanded to include genetically engineered pest resistance. There are also special uses of genetic techniques on pests themselves, such as sterile male insect release. And what that means is, like, you have this male population that are sterile, and they are there and they cannot reproduce. So once they mate, they don't have additional pest in the ecosystem anymore. Biological control methods are also quite popular. So use predators, parasites, and diseases of pests in a targeted way to suppress pest population. Use of microbial diseases of pests have become part of the chemical pesticide registration process and is treated below under chemical methods. Use of predators and parasites as biocontrol for pests are handled in one or more of three ways. So one method is conservation, and encouragement of naturally occurring biocontrol organisms by cultural techniques, or at least avoidance of harming them. Number second is augmentation of naturally occurring species by purchasing and releasing more of the same. And number three is classical biological control, in which new biocontrol species specific to pests are sought and introduced in the field. The chemical methods, on the other hand, there are quite a few and are used in pest management situations, but not all chemicals are alike from the standpoint of their range of action, toxicity, or persistent in the environment. So conventional method can also be utilized. Conventional pesticides currently refer to synthetically produced compounds that acts as direct toxins, such as nerve poison, stomach poison, etc. So you are releasing these specific pesticides in the field to control pests, and that's a conventional method. And there are, of course, many classes of chemical pesticides that can be utilized in here. And in addition, regulatory methods are also quite effective. Regulatory control refers to the role played by government agencies in trying to stop the entry or spread of pests into an area or into the country via inspection, quarantine, destruction of infested material, and other methods. And typically this happens in various port of entry, such as airports or other port of entries into the nation. So finally, the topic of pesticide resistance are shown in here. So resistance to pesticides is a serious and growing problem. Worldwide, more than 600 species of pests have developed some level of pesticide resistance. If resistance to a particular pesticide or family of pesticides evolve, these products can no longer be effectively used, thereby reducing the options available for pest management. Resistance is defined as a change in the sensitivity of a pest population to pesticide, resulting in the failure of a correct application of the pesticide to control the pest. Resistance can develop when the same pesticide or similar ones with the same mode of action are used over and over again. It often is thought that pests change or mutate to become resistant. However, it is not the individual pest that changes, but the population. When a pesticide is applied to a crop or a treatment site, a tiny proportion of the pest population, for example, one insect or weed in 10 million, may survive exposure to the pesticide due to its genetic makeup. When the pests that survive breed, some of their young will inherit the genetic trait that confers resistance to the pesticide. This pest will not be affected the next time a similar pesticide is used in the same place. If the same pesticide is applied often, the proportion of less susceptible individuals in the population will increase. When the pesticide applicator recognizes that the once highly effective pesticide no longer controlled the pest at the same rate, higher rates and more frequent applications become necessary until eventually the pesticide provides little or no control. The population may then be said to have become resistant. By illustration on the right, on the left in here, it shows how a resistant weed can dominate a field treated with the same herbicide year after year after year. The green symbol represents the wild type or susceptible weeds, and the red or orange symbols represent the resistant ones. If a herbicide is applied in this first year, it would kill the susceptible plants, but miss the few resistant ones. This will result in good seed production from the resistant plants, but little seed production by the susceptible plants. As a result, there's a small increase in the percentage of resistant plants in year two, as you can see in here. If the same herbicide is applied once again, there'll be a few seed produced by the susceptible plant, but the resistant plants will continue to set seeds. This results in an increase in the percentage of resistant weeds in year three. With the repeated use of the same herbicide, there is a greater increase in the percentage of resistant weeds, with most of the population resistant by year four and five. Although the genetic factors may differ among pests that have become resistant, all cases of resistance are driven by this process of what is called natural selection. So with respect to resistant management, IPM is definitely a good technique. So growers can help delay the development of resistance by applying pesticides only when they're needed, by rotating between different chemical classes, and by using rates of pesticides within the label range. Integrating non-chemical approaches such as pheromone mating disruption and cultural control, as mentioned earlier, can also delay the resistance of pesticides. Well, thank you for listening. Please remember to subscribe to this channel. Thank you.